Well, good evening, family, and welcome to our third lesson in a study we've entitled Divine Applause. It's from a book by that name. You know, it's surprising when you think about it how frequently the New Testament mentions money and giving. It's a core theme in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus talked about doing something secretly and receiving a reward from God. But you know, even before Jesus took on the subject of giving, John the Baptist had already started that ball rolling. John was an extreme risk taker when it came to his faith. You know, his advice to King Herod cost him his head, which was delivered to the king on a platter. One day John was preaching. Okay, more likely he was yelling, but still he was preaching. It was a serious kind of in-your-face message. He wanted the crowd to know that simply coming to the river for a dunking wouldn't be enough to save their souls. His message introduced the idea of bearing the fruit of repentance. That's in Luke chapter 3, verses 8 and 9, if you want to look it up. The crowd seemed interested, so they asked, to bear this kind of fruit, this fruit of repentance, what do we need to do? And unlike some consultants who use a whole lot of words to say very little, John used a few words to say a lot. He replied to him and said this in verse 11 of Luke chapter 3. He says, "Anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same." Essentially, John says, be a giver. Sounds pretty basic, doesn't it? I mean, in the economy of repentance and bearing fruit, which is the life John was talking about, preaching about, spreadsheets in the bottom line just don't apply. He was actually talking about risky faith. His advice was aimed at everyone in the crowd, which we can assume included everyone from those who were well-heeled to those who were just down and out. This giving way of life was for everyone. Maybe that's why Jesus said in his sermon, when you give, not if you give, in Matthew chapter 6, verse 2. You know, serious talk about giving makes some people break out in hives. When John was preaching to the crowd about giving, I'm sure his words made them squirm as well. And squirming is to be expected to some degree, but that's no reason to avoid the subject. In order to get a clear look at giving, it kind of helps us to understand the three different parties that are involved in those gifts. First, obviously, there's the recipient. Our gifts can fund the work of the church. It can heal the sick. It can spread the gospel. It can feed the hungry. It can care for orphans. The list of possible recipients is actually endless. But you know, there's also another party in giving, and that's the giver. Jesus said when we give in secret, our Father will reward us, and these rewards take on a variety of forms. But there's also a third party to our giving. Maybe most importantly, that third party is God. We give because we are children seeking to please our Father, and our gifts impact Him personally. Remember Abel's gift that attracted God's gaze? We talked about it in subsequent weeks. The memory of that gift remained, you know, etched in God's heart, so much so that God still boasts about that gift today in Hebrews 11, chapter 4. Think of this like a child's drawing that is still displayed on God's fridge so all the family, and that's us, can see it. And you know, it's funny, even before mankind was needy, back when there were no orphans and no homelessness and no hunger or thirst, gifts were still given to God. This was true long before His children were in need of charity from each other. In other words, giving was not directed toward God so that it could be used for ministry or humanitarian purposes. The gifts were for God, although He was in need of nothing. Still, God has a desire for connection with us. And in the same way that gifts connect us to one another, giving connects us to our Father in heaven, which is what we've been talking about in this study. Paul wanted the first century Christians to know their cash gifts, their financial gifts to him were he says this in Philippians 4:18, they were a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. Their gifts not only met Paul's personal needs, but they also brought pleasure to God. You know, we're bombarded by fundraising appeals. Many of the needs are legitimate and important, but right now we're not talking about meeting the needs of the world. Instead, we're talking about our need to connect to God and His desire for us to be connected to Him. as we talk about giving, we kind of got to take a step back and see the big picture. And you may be thinking, why are we talking about giving so much? You're preaching a sermon series on it, and now this. Well, you know, it's one of the ingredients Jesus mentioned in his Sermon on the Mount. It's not just a command to be kept. It's one of the ways we step into relationship with God. And in response to our gifts, God likes to show us that he notices. Often he lets us know of his delight through a gift of his own. Jesus would call these rewards. You might call them blessings. Connected to Jesus' sermon in Matthew 6, Jesus tells us to give freely, storing up treasure in heaven, and to not worry about our basic needs, food, clothing, shelter. Why? He said our Father would provide these things back in verses 25 through 34. God sees us and our sacrifices, and he has our back. Listen to what he says in Matthew chapter 6, verse 26. He says, look at the birds of the air. They don't sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? You know, Jesus compares us in that entire passage to birds and grass. Those are living things that don't worry about clothing or housing or their next meal. So why should we worry? And that's not just me asking, by the way. God sees and promises to meet our basic needs, even when we give outside the budget, and even when we don't follow the accepted rules of sound financial management. He is pleased with our gifts, even when they seem completely irresponsible by the world's standards. Sounds crazy, doesn't it? But let's face it, most of us are not birds and most of us are not grass. I mean, really, who never worries about getting the bills paid, about making the rent, or wondering how we're going to make do with the rising cost of gas and groceries and inflation and everything else that's going on? What about those of us who like to have a few extra shirts in the closet, or, you know, savings for retirement or college, or that rainy day situation? You know, on the flip side, picture a single mom who gives for the first time and shortly afterwards receives an unexpected raise at work, or a couple commit to a gift from their savings and then they receive an unexpected tax return of a similar amount. Or a family gives away a car, and then someone gives them a nicer car than the one they gave away. We've all heard stories such as these. And maybe you've got one of your own. And I believe the reason this happens is because God gets our attention when we get his attention. Still, people will often get very testy, you know, when Christians suggest that God blesses those who give. The extreme version of such blessing talk is known as what we hear today called prosperity theology. The idea that God will prosper your wealth and health in direct response to your faith and good needs. Let me just say unequivocally, this theology is toxic and even wicked at times. It motivates people to do the right thing for the wrong reasons. But one thing bad doctrines often have is they're born out of a deep-rooted biblical truth. That's the case with prosperity teaching. Dozens of scriptures mention the blessing or the rewards and the favor of God that rest on those who give and share generously with the poor. Just read Proverbs. There Solomon says it over and over. You know, when you step out and take risks, seeking a connection with God, rewards happen. But to understand this truth biblically, we need to understand what's going on behind God's rewards. Remember, God is connecting with you. And these rewards are personal encounters with the living God. And that should get your attention. And it should warrant your love and your worship and your praise. When Peter went fishing and heard Jesus call out to him to throw the nets on the other side of the boat, his obedience resulted in an overwhelming haul of fish. Peter was completely awestruck by the catch, but he seemed to be even more overwhelmed by the encounter he had with Jesus. There was no denying that Jesus had noticed him. So Peter gets out of the boat, takes off towards Jesus, leaving the fish behind. That's in John chapter 21, verse 7. Receiving a reward from God is wonderful, whether it's a surprise bonus at work or an unexpected gift from a friend or a relative or even a stranger or maybe some other financial reward. But don't forget what's really happening. God is connecting with you. When God blesses you with rewards, he's saying, I see you. I notice that. I'm watching you. You're pleasing me. God wants you to recognize that he recognizes you, and he wants to get personally involved in your circumstances. We give to connect with God, which in turn allows him to connect with us. Do you want to connect with God in this way? Do you want to be seen by him? Maybe it's time to take some risks in this area. Maybe it's time to step out and reach toward heaven with the things you hold on to tightly. Maybe that's your money. Maybe that's your possessions. Just as Jesus noticed that little widow lady in the temple who gave so generously, he notices us when we give. And if you're serious about your gifts to God, he will see it. And he will let you know that he sees it. And when that happens, you will hear his divine applause. Tonight you're going to explore different areas that get God's attention: giving, praying, fasting. But you need to remember, these are not commands simply to be obeyed, but rather they are ways in which we connect with God and God connects with us. Enjoy your study tonight. God bless.